watching us as we pay tribute. So God, we give you this memorial service, that your hand would be upon it, that you would bless it. Amen and amen. All right, we're going to be blessed now by the music of Sounds of Blackness.
The world's crumbling down, I said, here's my secret. When I wanna cry, some people like to run away. Hold on,
hold on.
Change is coming,
change is coming.
Hold on.
Shout out from Sounds of Blackness to the Barber family, that we love you and everything is gonna be all right. Y'all agree with that? Everything is gonna be all right. And I want y'all to sing along. Would you put your hands up like this for me?
La la
la la
la
la
la.
Don't worry about a thing.
Hold on.
I said you can make it.
You can make it.
Hold on.
Amen. That's the way to start it out right there. We are going to have scripture reading from Collis Barber.
My kids wanted to come up here with me. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 21 through 33. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those who hope is in him. To the one who seeks him, it is good to wait quietly for salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man to bear the yoke while he is young. Let him sit alone in silence, for the Lord has laid it on him. Let him bury his face in the dust. There yet may be hope. Let him offer his cheek to one who will strike him, and let him be filled with disgrace. For no one is cast off by the Lord forever. Though he brings grief, he will show compassion. So great is his unfailing love, for he does not willingly bring affliction or grief to anyone. Amen.
Let us pray. God, we pray that you would show up in such a way that this field on which Marion Barber III ran, this field on which he showed his success, at least on this campus, I pray that you would turn this field into a sanctuary, that you would turn it into a place of worship, that you would turn it into a place of healing and comfort and strength for the family, that you would turn it into a place where you would get glory, that you would open up our hearts and minds in such a way that though we feel pain in our heart, though we have a deep sense of loss, which is real, our hearts are also open for you to strengthen us, for you to further develop us, for you to show us how our lives right here and right now, moving forward, can pay tribute to Marion Barber III, a son, a nephew, a brother, a teammate. God, we pray that you would take this time to your glory and we would be strengthened by it. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 I guess I just put Marion Barber III on every field that University of Minnesota's ever played on, even though I think his games were, I remember in the Metrodome. Right. I remember the games in the Metrodome. But we're going to have another selection by the Sounds of Blackness.
I know it's only Wednesday, but can I get an amen?
Amen.
Everybody say, Marion.
Marion.
We love you.
We love you.
Marion.
Marion.
You are royalty.
You are royalty.
Because I want everybody to know his spirit is here. Mm-hmm. And we want to dedicate this especially to mom and to all the family. We just told you to hold on, change is coming. But now we want to say, hold on just a little while longer because everything's going to be all right.
Ooh.
We will now have acknowledgments and condolences by Leslie Harris, followed by the obituary reading from Antoine Council.
Hi, everyone. How you doing, Uncle? thank you all for being here to celebrate my big cousin Marion, and for those who couldn't be here today, but send their love all the same. I'd like to take a moment to thank you all for the calls, texts, cards, prayers we've received over the past few weeks. At the request of my aunt and uncle, today I'm going to highlight one of the many beautiful messages my family has received by reading a letter from a woman named Jenny. It goes, "Dear Karen, I would like to introduce myself as I don't believe we officially met when I was a football trainer at U of M. Hello, I am Jenny. I would introduce myself in person, but I am so sorry I will not be able to make it to the memorial. I would like to remember him as the Marion I knew before he went to the NFL. As much as I would love to support everyone that loved him, I'm finding it to be more personal for myself to go through my old college box of memories and process all those emotions privately. I saw you and your family quite a few times and knew you because of Marion. I would like to start off by saying, as a mother, I cannot understand the pain you are feeling after losing a child. Marion's death hit me like a gun punch and brought up a lot of old memories. I'm writing you this letter to process his death myself, but also to try to help and bring back some beautiful memories of your son. You had the reputation that you would do anything for your sons, and were very involved in your children's lives, a mama bear, if you will. And I knew I wanted the reputation you had if or when I ever became a mother. The support of a mom that would stand up to anyone and put her family first is really powerful. I have thought about you from time to time. Seems strange since we have not actually met, but regarding the commitment and dedication you have to your children, you stood out to me. I really try to emulate that in my own life. I would like to say to you, thank you for the blessing of Marion. I remember the day I met Marion. I was this insecure yet outgoing sophomore in college. Blonde hair, big blue eyes, and clothes that I would never wear now. Modest yet tacky. I went to a new class and Marion walked in. I couldn't take my eyes off of him. His jawline, his smile, his high cheekbones, his muscle. That's a good looking guy, I thought. With a newspaper in his hand, he sat down two chairs over from me. I saw that there was a picture of him, and I asked what the article was about. He said they are having issues with having enough athlete housing. I asked what sport he played, and in true Marion fashion, he replied, golf. He kept a straight face for about 5 seconds. My brain was trying to process how someone with this physique could be a golfer. This is the moment I knew he loved to joke around. I introduced myself, and he said his name was Marion. Later that night, I was talking to my girlfriend about this guy I had met named Marion. He told me she had never heard of him. Oh, sorry. She told me she had heard of him. I was filled with excitement, feeling I had a reason to talk to him the next day. When he arrived in class, I burst out, "My friend has heard of you," thinking this would impress him. I said, "Marion Jones, right?" He busted out laughing when my face went flush red because I could tell something was off. He politely explained Marion Jones was a female track star. I died a little bit of embarrassment inside. I was excited to have class with him. However, this was a few days before the day that changed our lives forever, September 11th. The following fall, when I became a football trainer, Mary and I had many conversations. We had so much in common. We grew up miles from each other in Plymouth, but never went to the same school. We talked about what high school was like for each of us. While thinking about it now, I'm surprised I had never heard of him. I went to Maple Grove High School, but mind you, we didn't even have a football field at the time because the school was so new. If my mind serves me correctly, we did not win one game during my time there. During our conversations, he talked about how much he loved his family, especially his brothers. We talked about the meaning of his tattoos. I asked him personal questions. Do you only play because you feel pressure from your family? He told me it was quite the opposite. He was so open with me. It was like talking to someone I knew for years. I wish my memory would be clear with all the details, but I just remember these bits and pieces. It was the following day that he was on the front paper with his dad. The article was about how his dad did not pressure him and basically confirmed a large portion of our conversations. This was so touching to me that I saved the paper. You'll find that exact paper in this envelope. I feel like the paper needed to go home to your family where it belongs. I have also included a game day program from when he was on the cover. I think I saved two from every game, so I'm happy to give this to you. I saved quite a few papers from my time in college, so I picked out a few highlights, and they are in this folder as well. I want you to know I really consider him a friend. One of my favorite things in life is finding another human you can instantly connect with and feel seen, heard, and enjoy each other's company. I feel that Marion shared a side of himself with me that most others did not get to experience. I feel like I truly knew him at this time in his life. Aside from the ease of our conversation, he had this playful demeanor and could always make me laugh, like tugging my hair gently as he ran past to get my attention, or standing so close to me after you made a touchdown that I couldn't not notice, almost to say, "Hey, did you see that?" Of course, he never said that out loud. His passion, of course, led him to stardom and success with the Cowboys. I was able to enjoy and be happy for him and his success from afar. I don't have much to say regarding the last 10 years, except I hope he truly enjoyed the moments in his life. He deserved happiness. He brought so much happiness to others, whether personally having the pleasure to know him or being Marion the Barbarian. He was such a large and important chapter in my life. This has been difficult to process the feelings of closure since I never officially felt there was a goodbye. Writing this has helped me to relive some of my favorite memories. I hope you get some comfort in knowing how much he changed the world in small and, of course, big ways. I have more stories and details. If you ever want to get a glass of wine when I'm in Minnesota or you're in Georgia, I would love to officially meet the mom to so many. I wanted to reach out and connect mother to mother. I'm so sorry for your loss and the loss of the special light we all got from him. Thanks, Jenny. So on behalf of our family, the Barbers, the Haddons, the Williamses, we would like to thank you all for your notes like this one and the many flowers and cards we received from near and far. We'd also like to thank the entire Jerry Jones family and the Dallas Cowboys, the National Football League Players Association, the University of Minnesota, and the College of Education and Human Development, Minnesota Gopher Football, B Studios, and Gary Hines and the Sounds of Blackness for the wonderful music selection. If I could leave you with one thing or one thought to set the tone of the moment of this moment and this day, it would be the words from Marion's father, my Uncle Cool. This is not a memorial, it's a celebration of life. We play hip hop and everything. Thank you for celebrating Marion's life with us.
Good afternoon. Marion Sylvester Barber III, affectionately known as Lil Man, Big Baby, Baby, or MB3, was born June 10th, 1983, to Marion Sylvester and Karen Pauline Barber in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Marion is the oldest of three sons, brother Dominique, Dom, wife Brittany, brother Thomas, Bubba, and his wife Ashley. Marion did everything early. He was walking by 9 months, and he refused to keep a diaper on once he figured out how to get it off. As a toddler, he would introduce himself as Marion Sylvester, the Barber, the Third. Marion, as a youngster, attended Zion Missionary Baptist Church. Although he was not a member of the church, Marion supported several churches here in his hometown of Minneapolis and the Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas area. Educated in the Wayzata School District, graduating from Wayzata High School in June 2001, Marion would go on to the University of Minnesota, earning a scholarship to play football. A business and marketing education alum, Marion is well known for his legacy as a member of the Gopher football team and a standout NFL career. He was equally devoted to his faith, family, friends, and philanthropy for inner-city youth. As a lifelong learner, he was often applying his curious spirit to new ventures. Marion has always supported children. The Barber Foundation was developed to support and empower urban youth by helping them achieve their highest level of independence through mentorship, community involvement, academics, tutoring, as well as health and fitness. Founded in 2007, the Barber Foundation supported schools in both the Minneapolis and Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas areas. Marion made his transition on June 1, 2022. Preceded in death by his grandparents, Marion S. Barber Sr., William and Dolores Haddon, his aunt Walinda Haddon, his uncle Edward Haddon, together with his family, he is at peace now. Marion leaves his loving family to cherish his memory. His parents, Marion and Karen, his brother, Dom, sister-in-law, Brittany, niece, Malaya, nephews, Titus and Tatum, and his youngest brother, Thomas. MB called him Doodoo sometimes. Only MB knows why. And his sister-in-law, Ashley. His maternal family, the Haddons, Aunt Donna, Kim, Walinda, Uncles Michael, Kenny, Edward, and all of their children, Cahill, Lakeisha, Thomas, Nicole, Natasha, Michelle, Michael Jr., Gilbert, Brian, William, Dewan, Joshua, his paternal family, the Barbers, Grandma Mary Ann Barber, Uncles Derek and Collis Barber, Thomas, Uncle Lynn, Williams, Aunt Denise Barber and Stacy Barber, and all of their children, John, Mary, Collis, Karis, Leslie, Bakari, the Williams and the Full of Love families, and a host of uncles, aunts, cousins, family, and friends.
Well, I have words from Unc Lynn by Thomas Williams.
Good afternoon. Marion Barber III was my first nephew, and I miss him dearly. I'm going to tell you a story about Marion. One summer when I was visiting Minnesota as a teenager, I remember my brother Marion and Karen wanted to go out for a night on the town for a date. Well, MB3, a toddler, was a child that only wanted to be with his parents. He was really particular about the company he kept, even at that time. Anyway, once he was distracted, my brother and my sister, they made a dash for it. It didn't last long, though. Once MB3 realized something wasn't right, he whined all night, and that kid could cry. But what seemed like forever, he finally dozed off and went to sleep. And from that moment forward, Mary and I had a very special bond. I love him and I miss him dearly. Mary and I would have conversations about everything. Family, movies, football, even my military service and the many relationships formed during those times. I will always remember the most beautiful thing my nephew said to me. Prior to my wife and my kids, this is my son Bakari, my daughter Leslie was just up speaking. Before we moved to Minnesota, we were a little reluctant. We're from Michigan, but the weather can be pretty brutal too. So even though we were hesitant, Marion says, "Uncle, family will always keep you warm." Marion loved his family deeply. This I'm sure of. And he was so proud of his brothers, Don and Thomas. The road ahead will be rough, but let us remember Marion as the kind spirit and generous soul that he is. May his love for us and our love for him strengthen us and keep us warm. We love you, Marion, forever.
Well, now I have tribute through speakers, starting with Thomas Tepay and Lawrence Maroney, followed by Coach Glenn Mason, and then Dominique Barber.
How everybody doing today? As per usual, Thomas and Marion making me speak first. They've been doing it, grooming me for this since I stepped on campus. And excuse me, bear with me, man, this is rough. Never been in this position, and I just had to really say my last goodbyes to my brother. Marion was not a teammate to me, not a guy I made history with, not a guy I just met in Minnesota, but truly my brother. So this one hurts. It hurts deep. And to the family, I'm gonna always be here with y'all. We all gonna have to figure out how to make it past this day, but I know we'll figure it out. I had a speech in my head, and the moment I stepped on this stage, mine went blank. I love Marion. Everybody know our relationship. They know how we got down. It was undeniable. I just want to say sorry to you guys. I know this hurts. And before I leave, and I'm going to keep it short, man, I know I shouldn't do it, but I have this feeling, and the reason I'm saying sorry, because even though Marion, I did all that he allowed me to do for him, I can't shake the feeling of it's something more I should have done. And I'm sorry because I couldn't figure out the more. And I apologize, and I'm sorry to the family. And I love y'all dearly. And Marion, till we meet again, I love you too, brother.
What up, though? Ain't that what he say? What up, though? T, you African. All the time. Mama Barber, football brought us together. But that's not what's keeping us together. My teammates, man, boys before me, boys after me, boys in the league. You know, so many times we're strong men. We're built strong, built for tough. We're tough, like a rock Chevy, but my brother was hurting. And there's nothing I could have done to help him. no phone call, driving out there, going to see him, spending time with him. Like he said, wish there was more he could have done. We all wish the same thing. But one thing I can say and will say is that I know he's at peace now. That's not where we want him to be, but we can't be selfish. We're all going to travel that road one day. And I'm grateful that everybody's here to celebrate him. Do I miss him? Yes, I do. I don't have words to say. But Mama, your son is in front of you. And I will always be in front of you as long as I have breath on this earth. To Mr. Barber, Sadata. Sadata. And I used to listen, hear the words, rest in peace, rest in peace. I never did quite understand it until now, until I got the word from him. And then I called Mom and she said, yes, it's true. And that's when I had to let it all go. I can't carry the burden no more. There's no need to carry it. He's free now. Let's let him be free. Let's celebrate him. Let's enjoy him. Let's remember that as long as we have breath, those that you say you love, you make sure you tell them you love them. Don't wait till this last minute. And my Gopher teammates, the guys I put in the league, I thank y'all for coming and showing support. Everybody, we thank you for celebrating Marion. And let's do just that, celebrate him. And for those you love, tell them you love them. Lawrence, I love you, little brother. Teammates, I love y'all too. I appreciate y'all. Thank y'all. I'm here for you, Mom.
Glenn Mason's my name. I had the privilege of recruiting and coaching Marion Barber, and it's really moving to me to get around all the former players. It's just kind of sad that it takes an event like this to bring us all back together. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention how many players said, Coach, man, we wish we had a place like this to play when we were here. And I said, well, take solace in the idea Marion Barber and guys like you made this place possible. And that's the gospel truth, because they turned the program around and got it going. And my condolences to the Barber family. I really feel like you're the first family of Gopher football. I don't know of another family that had three sons play with the success and the impact that those three guys had. And ever since June 1, I've really been struggling. Tears of sadness and smiles of joy. Tears of sadness because I, like all you, miss Marion greatly. Very sad that maybe we couldn't have helped him more. But joy in the memories, unbelievable. You know, as I go around town, people, since it happened, stop me and say, oh, man, I remember Marion Barber, this run, that. And I think, well, I remember those runs, too. But, you know, what I remember more was the kid, the smile. You know, that picture on the end there, that smile in Marion Barber, that's what I have. That's what I saw, you know, each and every day. Fans, they get to see a kid play, you know, 12 times a year, either in person or on TV. But if you're a coach or a teammate, you get to see the guy every day. And it's not just about how good a player is, it's what kind of, you know, person he is. But I got to tell you, I got to give you a little history here about how it all started with Marion. He went to Wayzata High School, and that's where I live. And when he was a senior in high school, he wasn't getting recruited very heavily. I'm not sure he was getting recruited at all, including us. And it was late in recruiting, and we wanted to make sure we didn't make any mistakes. And I said to Gordy Shaw, who recruited that area, I said, tell me about this Barber kid out at Wayzata.
And I thought about that because I was old enough. I remember when I was at the University of Illinois and we recruited his dad out of Detroit. I think his nickname was Barbecue back then. It wasn't MB2, it was Barbecue, you know. And he was a great player, and we didn't get him, but he went to Minnesota, and he had a great career. So I had the whole staff, and we put the film on, and we're watching the film, and Gordy's not saying anything negative about him, but he said, you know, sometimes as coaches, you look for reasons to recruit a guy. Sometimes you look for reasons not to recruit a guy. And Marion, one of my favorite sayings is some guys are born on third base and think they hit a triple. That wasn't Marion. No one thought he was that good. And so we're watching the film, and Gordy's saying, well, you know, he's a real good player, and he's a good kid, and he's a little short, he's a little this, and he's a little that. And I used to like to play devil's advocate with the coaches. So I said, maybe we should recruit him as a defensive back. And my defensive coordinator, defensive back coach, David Gibbs, he looked up and says, what makes you see that this kid could play Big Ten defensive back? I said, I don't know. I said, he intercepted Joel Maurer from Creighton Durham a couple times. Nobody else did it the whole year. And Gibbs says, he can't play. Well, I got in an argument with him, you know. Kind of lost my temper a little bit. And I said, well, we're going to recruit him as a defensive back. Gibbs was mad. I didn't care. So anyway, we called Marion up. We brought him for a visit as a defensive back. He said, I'm a running back. He got no other offers. Defensive back. So he doesn't take it. A couple guys commit. We're out of scholarships. I had to call him. But the more I thought about it, I think I ran into Marion downtown or something. I started thinking about it. I called him up, and I said, you know what? We're going to take a third defensive back, which really ticked Gibbs off. And I said, and he didn't have anything going, so he says, okay, I'll take it. So he took the scholarship. He was coming in as a defensive back. The springtime of his high school season, he made an appointment to come see me. And he came in. He said, Coach, I need a favor. I said, what's that? He said, I know you don't think I can play running back. Just give me a chance, 1 year. Just give 1 year. Give me a chance to play running back, and if I'm not good enough to play running back, you can switch me to any position you want, and I'll do the best I can. I figured, well, he's not going to play his freshman year anyway. What the heck's the difference? So I said, sure. Well, he came in, and literally, I might be exaggerating, literally the first day of practice, Vic Adamley, the running back coach, he comes running over to me and says, we made a mistake on this kid. He can play, you know? And the rest became history. And you think back during that period, it had to be the greatest running back group of guys, greatest running back room, as they say now, the University of Minnesota ever had. You know, you think about the names that were all good, all 1,000-yard gainers. You imagine that? And that's when you only played 11 games. They play 12 now, so you got to put a little asterisk now. But you think about Thomas DePay was up here. You think about Lawrence Maroney, who was up here. Tellus Redman, Amir Penix, Terry Jackson. I mean, the list goes on. But the guys that got a lot of publicity back then, rightfully so, which was not only, I think, the greatest running back duo in the University of Minnesota history. When they played, they were the best running back duo in the country, and that was Barber and Maroney. And boy, did they compliment each other. You know, Marion was kind of quiet. He didn't say anything. Lawrence, you couldn't shut him up, you know? I'm going to tell you, he's lost for words today. That might be the first time in his entire life. But they were great players, I can tell you that. People ask me, you have any memories? What are your two favorite memories or three favorite memories about Marion Barber? The first one is we're playing Alabama in the bowl game. Very first play from scrimmage, coming off her own goal line, Marion carries the ball, and he fumbles it, and they recover. And I'm standing on the sideline. I'm not real happy, you know. And here comes Marion, and he takes his helmet off, and he gives me that big smile, and he says, don't worry, Coach, I got this. What are you going to say to that? He ends up MVP of the game, and we kick Alabama's ass in the meantime. The other thing, and Lawrence says, don't tell that story. I got to tell the story. Like it was yesterday. There was one day I was leaving work. One day I was leaving work, and I'm waiting at the light at 15th Avenue, just sitting there. And all of a sudden, right through the light, speeding through the light, is these two guys on a motor scooter. Maroney's driving, and Barber's on the back. Two best running backs in the country. My two running backs. Right through there. laughing their head off. And I thought for a second, I said, you know what? Yeah, they're two great running backs, but you know what they really are? They're two college kids just having a good time. I'll never forget that viewing. Thank God they didn't get in an accident. And, you know, especially with no helmet, no sunglasses, no nothing. Probably no driver's license, you know. I hate to say that. Then he went on to pro football. I remember the day when he was going out early, and draft day, I got the phone rang, and it was Bill Parcells from the Dallas Cowboys. He said, hey, I got a question for you about Marion Barber. He said, I'm looking to take a guy that can play about 8 snaps a game, really tough kid, could play on special teams, and really good kid, wouldn't cause us any problems. I said, that's Marion Barber. Next thing you know, Vic walks in and says, Dallas Cowboys just took him. Not long after that, maybe the year after that, I was in Dallas, and I ran into Jerry Jones, and I introduced myself, and he went on and on about what kind of player he thought Marion was, and he described him as the steal of the draft the year before. And this past winter, I was down in Florida, and I saw Bill Parcells, who was the coach, obviously, of the Cowboys when he played there. And I went up and said hello, and he stood up. He introduced me to everybody. But he introduced me as the coach that sent Marion Barber to the Dallas Cowboys. And he talked about what kind of player he was. He talked, in our vintage, when you say a guy was a throwback player, that's a compliment. He said he was tough. He'd do everything. You could count on the guy. He was really something special. The last time I saw Marion in person was after he retired, and I got a phone call one day, and he said, Coach, I'm in town. I'd like to have dinner. And I said, great. He said, where do you want to go? I said, why don't you just come over to the house? We'll have dinner here. So he came over to the house, and he bought me a bottle of Cristal champagne. Now, that's high dollar, baby, you know. And I said, well, great. And I said, thank you. And he said, no, thank you. Open it up. So anyway, I opened it up, and during the course of dinner, he didn't drink it, but he made me drink every drop. And I'm not a big drinker, and I started slurring my words, and he had that laugh. He thought that was the funniest thing in the world, and I cherish that memory great. You know, in closing, I've always thought these players will tell you, and I got to mention that great to see all you guys. One of my former players, Alex Daniels, came up and said, you know, Coach, we all hated you when we played for you. We love you now. Well, I loved you then, and I still love you guys. So I'm just trying to do my job. But, you know, I've always thought, I talked about that football, first and foremost, is a game of respect. Game of respect. You know what? You can't buy it. You can't hope for it. You can't pray for it. You got to earn it. And maybe one of the greatest compliments I can give Marion Barber is that he had the respect of everybody that he came in contact. So in closing, I'd have to say Marion Barber, MB, as he liked to go by, MB3, rest in peace, and I assure you, all of us miss you greatly. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. As Leslie said, you know, it's overwhelming the outpour that we have received. You know, thank you. That's really all I got for that. I know we won't be able to personally thank everyone, but, you know, just know we appreciate you. So, I'm going to try to muscle through this, so bear with me, please. Got my sidekick up here to make sure I'm straight. Dear Marion, what up, though, big baby? To most, you were and always will be Marion the Barbarian, the Hulk, MB3. The guy who would rather pick up a blitz than run the ball. You'd rather have one of your old linemen spike the ball when you scored than you. You wanted others to feel your joy and excitement you had. You're the guy who looked for contact, rarely shied away from it. Took every opportunity to get better. In the weight room, you ate weights. You had no business putting up the numbers you did. I remember early on you talked about no one really believing in you, even though you were beyond a special talent. I remember in baseball, you were the man in center field, leadoff batter. You could go to the gym and take over a basketball game, intramural basketball, that is. Whatever you touched, you were good at it. You showed us silently what it would take to not be average. You worked when the lights were off. You worked when no one was watching. We saw you. You did it to be the best you could be for your teammates. And you had the same passion for those you let in your inner circle, which wasn't many. From youth to adulthood, you cared about people. I don't need to be specific. You know who you are. You loved being around people. You loved life. Going back to no one believing in you, you're one of the pieces that built this stadium. I'm pretty sure on your and even my recruiting visit, they told us the plans of a new stadium. Coach Mason, you remember that? Just kidding, Coach. Thanks for believing in us. That stuff didn't matter to you. All you cared about was your team and your teammates and getting better. The competition in your running back room at Minnesota in 2003, I mean, you all made each other better. You took the torch from TT and led. Whether it was key drill or 9-on-7, it was your national championship every day, every practice. The running backs looked for your guidance, but the team saw what you were doing for all of us. You had a special place in your heart for them Cowboys. I think 2008, when you guys were stacked. Offense, defense, special teams, stacked. I remember you talking about the importance of practice and how your team competed. What that meant to you, what your teammates meant to you. How you would do whatever it took to win, no matter what. Some would ask, you know, why? Why was it so important to him? It was because you loved him. You didn't want to let anyone down. You loved your teammates. You loved your staff. They were and will always be your family. I still don't know how you guys didn't win the Super Bowl that year. That was also a joke. You adored your teammates. You adored, greeted, and respected staff members, coaches, trainers, security guards, janitorial staff, everyone. You loved people, you respected everyone's role, and you gave them the time they deserved. I love how you never understood why so many people loved you. You would ask, you know, why do so many people want my autograph? I didn't do anything. Why? Why? I just love what I do. Do what I love. Although it wasn't your favorite thing to do, you took the time to love your fans back. I remember you would have a stack of mail and open it all. Fan mail first. People from all over the world will send you cards and ask you to sign it and send it back. You would do just that with no hesitation. After games, you would take pictures with kids. Adults, not so much. You had a smooth, respectful way to keep it moving to adults wanting pictures. It was a joy to see that. It was a joy to watch so many people, so many fans love you. Here's the thing. Many know you as that. I know you as my big brother. As a kid, I remember when you would always let me tag along with you, even if you didn't want me to. You always had your arm around me to make sure I was doing okay and felt included. I know you as coming home on a bye week, fresh off a plane to visit me and Willie. We had ramen noodles, spoiled milk, and some other garbage food we had from the night before. All to say, let's go. Go to the grocery store where all three of us had carts. It was like supermarket sweep with no timers. We would have food for weeks. I know you as the guy that wanted nothing but the best for our younger brother. The guy who gave Thomas everything he wanted and needed. More so needed, as Thomas doesn't ask or say much of anything. I love you, Doc. We'll hold it down for him. Oh, and B, by the way, Bubba's in good hands. He found a good one. She'll take care of him. I know you as the greatest son parents could ask for. One that would give anything and everything to make sure they didn't have to worry. I remember you saying you could never do enough to pay them back. Well, MB, you did. And they know. You're the guy that me and Thomas could look up to and always will look up to. The guy that took care of us, our family, friends, teammates, kids, and more. You cared about all of us. You got a unique relationship with my family. Your dry humor to show your love to Britt. Your DQ cakes you would bring for your little ones. Always and never forgetting to mention, you know, the Bible does say be fruitful, which I guess you were onto something as we got number 4 coming next month. I think the hardest part for me is, my kids won't have Uncle Marion. But that's okay. I know. That's what's hardest for you too. But know this. I will teach my kids your spirit, your ways. They will know who Uncle Marion was and what he was about. Gentle-hearted, loving and kind. Your spirit will always be with them, with us. 2 Corinthians 13:11. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. Bro, the storm is over. You can rest in peace. We will hold it down for you and finish what you started. You will forever be my best friend. You will always, and you always have been and always will be my hero. I love you. Dominique Germain.
We'll now have a brief time of remarks from family and friends. If you would like to share, this stage is open to you. We would ask, just out of respect to the family, that each one speaking would limit their remarks to about 2 minutes. So I was given strict orders on that. But this time is open. If there are those family and friends that would like to share any remarks briefly, you are welcome to come and do that now.
Marion Barber was a king. My name is Billy Clark, and I was Marion's attorney in Dallas. We were more than just attorney clients. He was a good friend. I shared a lot of text messages with Marion up until the end of May. That's the hardest thing for me now, is to know that when I look at my phone, I'm not going to see any more texts from Marion. But what I can tell you, and I spent a lot of time with Marion at my house. I recently got married. He made an effort to come over to my house to meet my new wife. He sent me a long text on my birthday. But I know I can tell you that Marion loved God. immensely. So to the family, we're in Dallas, but no, our love extends out to you here. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Otis. Marion was my first real friend. He was someone I could just talk to and just be with. There were so many times that we just sat in my basement and did absolutely nothing. And it's those times I will genuinely, genuinely miss. Being with his family and our families being together felt like family. And as I look out to this crowd of people, I remember what an effect he had on all of us and will continue to have on all of us. This is his legacy, this family that he's created across families. This brother was so blessed. I love that man. I will always love that man. And today is not my last goodbye. I refuse to say goodbye to him. He will be with me always, with every breath I take. Thank you.
Welcome. My name is Roy Artis. Go back to 1977 with Marion Jr. Marion III, I took him fishing, and we started catching fish, and I think he got hooked on fishing. And one day I took him out to my cabin where me and Marion would have to hook up chains and winches and get my dock out the water. So Marion was with us. I said, get ready to hook up everything. Marion said, no. And so we got the dock up to the shore. He got in the water and lifted the dock up over the bank. So a couple of days ago, I told Marion I was going to wait. I'm waiting for a sign. And the sign came to me with strength. Marion was strength. He's powerful. He's durable. He's intelligent. That's Marion Barber.
We just want to thank you for giving us the opportunity to say something. We honestly, I'm like Thomas, I talked to him earlier. He didn't know what he was going to say, but all of us will say something about Marion. I know a lot of us have shared many moments with Marion, whether teammates, Dallas Cowboys, or whatever, but we don't stand here as teammates. We don't stand here as Cowboys. We stand here today as brothers. It was a brotherhood. Time, I would share the time that I spent with Marion. I met some of his family. We stayed on the same floor in the Azure. And we all know about the ability of Marion when he played. That's something obviously we can't get out of our minds when you watch him and you know of Marion. But for me, I knew he was a unique individual. Like the gentleman said before, this guy was smart, not only talented, but I knew he was a special individual. obviously staying on the same floor, I would get off the elevator time to time, and I would hear some music. Marion would be over there playing the piano. And I had no idea that this guy was that gifted. I wish I had that talent. I often told him, I was like, man, if I knew how to play that piano, I'd be walking around this floor with my shirt off, you know, singing all the time. I did that anyway, but but yeah, man, we, like I said, I won't take up too much time. I know time is short for everyone, but I just want to extend my condolences. When I heard of the news, it shook me. It shook me to the core, like everybody else. And like Thomas said, and everybody that came in contact within the last 3 to 5 years or months, we often, and I played in my head, what could I have done? What could we have done differently? We don't know. But understanding what has transpired with him, not that we want him where he is, it would be selfish for us to have him here, but may he rest in peace.
Real quick, my name is Tashard Choice. My bad, make sure it don't fall down. I'm a teammate of Marion Barber. I came in 2008, and I really want y'all to understand something. Out of most things that I've been through in my life, this is one of the roughest things because of the type of person he was. And first and foremost, I'm going to say something. Like, I coach running backs now at the University of Texas. And how I coach my running backs is the power of example that I saw from MB3. My mom used to tell me the power of example matters more than the example of power. And so when I came into the running back room, me and Felix Jones, the first thing I was worried about is how much that Ricky Denham was going to be. And so if y'all don't know anything about Ricky Denham, it can get really pricey. And so one of the things I remember me and Felix were talking about it because he a first-round draft pick. I was drafted in 4, so he had to pay more money than me. And so when I'm in the room, and I just remember Marion coming up to us and saying, make sure somebody has Chick-fil-A for me on Friday morning. Make sure somebody has me a New Jersey Mike sub on the plane for Saturday. And that's how he was. And he said, man, you work too hard to give away your money. You work hard for that. Make sure you take care of your family with that. What you guys got to understand is, man, like I coach my running backs, and how I coach them and how I go about the game of football is not from how I played. It's from the example that some of the guys behind me, especially him, he taught me how to make every down count. He'll make a 3-yard run. Like Coach Pete, our running back coach back here for the Cowboys, to say he was excited about a 3-yard run. He'd be excited about a touchdown. But more importantly, he wanted to win. But he warmed my heart. Dumb, bro. It's killing me, dog. I love Holmes. And everybody here rock with MB. Because he was a real one, real solid dude through and through. He didn't care about anything but making sure he put other people before himself. And that's one of the things I take on. I make sure I text my mom, my parents every single day. But more importantly, now that's another reason to pull me out to bed. To make sure I give back. Like the coach just came up here and talked about ball, but now I got something to give to these jokers every single day. You don't have to worry, mom, pops. He gonna live on. And every single chance I got a chance to talk about that joke, I will. Because he meant that much to me. As much as this day means to me, I'm more than thankful because I'm gonna see my dog again. And we gonna dap up. He gonna squeeze my side to see if I'm fat still, but it's all good. That's what he always used to do to me. But I just want y'all to know, this has been one heck of a day, Dom. Mom, T, love y'all boys. Just know that. Every time you didn't even know, he talked great about y'all. I just want y'all to know that when y'all wasn't around, when I was just there, sitting there talking to him for 2 or 3 hours on the Lord, I'm gonna see my dog again. I thank y'all, appreciate you.
First of all, my name is Keith Davis. I played with Marion with the Cowboys. I played safety for 7 years, and I was with Marion. Condolences to the family. Respect. You raised a king. He was an awesome man. My friend, my brother. I remember the last time I saw him about 4 months ago. I said, Marion, come by the house. I said, I want to see you. Killer, I'm going to pull up on you. Because that's how we talk to each other. He was killer, I was killer. Killer, I'm about to pull up on you. So he pulls up to the house and he pulls in the driveway. And he gets out the car. He got his shirt off and he got a chain around his neck. And I'm looking at him and I'm standing in my driveway. I'm like, Killer, you look good. He said, nah, Killer, you look good. He said, but I've been training. I'm getting ready to box. He said, Killer, stand there. Don't move. Stand right there. And I'm saying, I said, all right, MB. I'm going to stand right here. So as I stand there and I'm looking, I'm like, don't move, Killer. Don't move. He charges me. And he get up on me. He give me about 10 punches. And he never touched me once. And then he hugged me. He said, Killer, do I got it? I said, you got it, Killer. I said, Killer, you got it. You ready, dog? You ready? And that's Marion. When he's with you, he's with you. That's my brother. And I hear him saying it right now. One of the last conversations we had. Killer, to be absent from the body is to be in the presence of the Lord. I say, you're right, Killer. Keep sending me them scriptures, Killer. I love them. And I'm going to send you some too. Go read this. Go read this. Go read that. And I would always do it. I just want to tell the family, we love Marion. We're going to miss him. But we know he's going to still be there. Mind, body, and soul. We might can't touch him physically. But the memories and the stuff that he said to us will go forever. Dom, Thomas, love you guys. We'll still be here, man. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Felix Jones. Like Tashard Choice, I came in with Tashard, and MB was already there. He was a myth to us because, you know, we knew what he brought to the Cowboys. We knew what he brought to the team. And all we wanted to do was get better and be good just like him. And he took us under his wing. He didn't allow us to be by ourselves. When I came in, speaking for myself, nervous. I'm in front of a bunch of guys who play football for a living, and I'm trying to get in there with them. And B was the first one come up, hey, how you doing? Marion Barber, nice to meet you. And then from there, it's been a brotherhood. Marion's always been a gem to me. He's always been there for me when I get down on myself, hey, get your energy back up, man. Let's keep playing. We got another play. The game ain't over. So for him to be there for myself and the younger guys at this point in time, it was definitely something that we needed, and forever love him for that. To the Barber family, man, you had a king. He's still a king in my eyes, and I appreciate you guys for allowing us to love on him too. And condolences to all the friends and the family. MB, we miss you. We love you, man. And take care.
My name's Ken Hamlin. I came from Seattle, and I had 3 years with MB in Dallas. And just real quick, I know with this family of guys up here, dominoes was something real big with us. And we would always get down, especially during lunchtime, and MB was right there always with his hands doing this right here, like, I got him, I'm on it. And because T.O. and MB was neighbors and I was right down the street, they would always call me over for things. So this one time, I don't even know if he remembered this, they called me down to the apartment, and T.O. had a reality show going on. And they had him and MB sitting down playing dominoes and expected some type of conversation to go on. Two cats that don't talk, especially in the media, you already know he don't want to talk to the media. MB, it ain't my day. So they called me over to be the starter of the conversation. So I'm trying to start a generic conversation with these two cats, and they both looking at me like, uh-uh. But soon as the cameras left, everybody leave, it's always the energy right back. MB is that guy, whatever, that's going to have the energy. He's hype. When he sees somebody, he's going to give you them hands, and he's going to love on you. Definitely going to miss that, man, because I'm a guy that we used to battle on. I was on the defensive side, and we used to battle during practice. It was still all love once we got off that field. So respect and love to the family, definitely condolences, and just appreciate the opportunity to come up and share the story.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Patrick Creighton. Like you said, as you can see, this Cowboy blood runs strong. And we definitely had to come out and salute our guy. You know, it's not a goodbye, it's a farewell. And it's till we meet again. I think my biggest word that I have that describes MB is loyalty. He was loyal to everyone that he came in contact with. Like they said, once you became part of his circle, you were his blood. It wasn't just about friendship or anything. You were his brother. And that's how he treated us. He had an old school drop top. And we became fans of some old school vehicles. He had a big orange, I think 72 Caprice, 73 Caprice. Yeah, and I had a 66 Impala SS. And remember when he got it done, he came to my house. And you could hear it coming up the street. And I was like, what is that noise? He was, hey, Sizzle, come outside. I got something to show you. Bro, is that you out there disturbing my neighbors? Let me go out here. So he comes out there, he said, hey, let's go take a ride. I said, all right, I'm gonna get in there. Let's go around the corner, man. And like MB, how he lived his life, nothing was gonna be slow. He was gonna put 100% into everything that he did. So he commits to do some donuts in my neighborhood. I immediately told him to stop the car without those choice words, and I hopped out and walked back to my house. I said, don't you ever put me in your car again like that, dude. He said, brother, you know I ain't gonna nothing happen to you. I said, I know that. I said, but I don't like to see my life flash in front of me. But the loyalty that he always showed us, just little stuff like that, he wanted to compete and push you to be great every day that he set foot on earth. Every day he woke up, says, come on, we got it, we got another rep. He tell him, hey, sprint, let's go, finish it out. Same way this one was us. It pushed us every day. And I think that's where the brotherhood started, because we wanted each one of us to be better. And for that, MB, I thank you.
Good evening. My name is Jesse Holly, and I played 3 seasons with Marion with the Cowboys. And I've been laughing because I've watched all of these posters fall down, these flowers fall down, and we all know that's Marion saying, I don't want this attention. Yeah. That's Marion said, I'm thankful you guys are here, but Marion said, I don't want the attention. I don't want the pictures up. I don't want the attention. He's always deflected the attention off of him, no matter how big of a star he was. Marion always treated you like you were the bigger star. He gave me the nickname Jeremiah Holly Grove. And he would always tell me, he said, Jeremiah Holly Grove, you the prophet. You the prophet. You gonna tell him like it is, Jeremiah Holly Grove. And he always said, read Jeremiah Holly Grove. And we could sit here and talk about football moments till we're blue in the face. I think the greatest thing that you'll hear each and every one of us talk about is the human that Marion was. You hear the generic term of he would give the shirt off his back. I watched him give the shirt off his back time and time and time again. You never were without when you were with Marion, whether it was laughs or what have you. Marion always made you feel as if you were the star of the room. And I miss my brother, because you don't run into that kind of people today. Who is that selfless, who's that generous, who's that caring. He was physical on the football field. He was a gentle giant off of it. And I'm gonna miss that. To the family, thank you for allowing all of us to borrow your brother, your son. But we have to remember, and even though it feels selfish, that he belongs to the Lord. And he was on loan to us temporarily. And now he's truly home. We can take solace in knowing that. That he's home. That he's watching over us. And that we now have to live on for him. And to have that generosity that he's shown to all of us. Thank you again.
Good afternoon. My name is Lusaka. Played played in Dallas for MB. That was my little brother, man. And you know, if you want to hear the same thing, we're all saying the same things about him, man. It's obvious the impact he made. And I think one of my favorite quotes truly exemplifies Marion, and it's be noticed by not being noticed. That's the way he lived his life. That's the way he walked, you know. And after we retired, it went some time from, you know, from communicating, you know, we lost touch for a while, but I feel really good about our last meeting, which was in May. I went to visit him, we broke bread, we spoke for about 3 hours, man, and, you know, it just felt like old times, you know. It was laughing, joking, and it was just, that's what I always keep with me. So just my words for you guys, just everything, whatever memory that you have of Marion, keep that close to you. And what I would say is, he's up there right now waiting for us. He just getting the party started early, man. So I'll see you soon, bro. I love you, man. Thank you all.
Hello, everybody. Sorry about that. Hello. My name is Andre Gerard. I was offensive lineman for MB. I should say MB was my inspiration to play the game. MB would have this one saying that he always said. And he said this to me the first time after we were in the huddle. It's a big fella. We get tired fast. And I remember telling MB, man, I need a break. He said, Dre, you got one more. You got a couple more. I said, nah, MB. You better do some of these next couple plays. I'm tired. And he said, Dre, it don't matter. I refuse to let one person tackle me. I said, what? What did you say? He said, I refuse to let one person tackle me. I was like, MB, what are you trying to say? He said, dude, don't worry about it. I ain't gonna let one dude take me down. I said, you believe that? He said, yeah. I guess I gotta dig a little bit deeper. And he used to come into practice when we'd be in stretch lines, and I don't know if the guys remember this, but he would say, do what you love, love what you do. I said, MB, so you're telling me everything? He said, Dre, do what you love, love what you do. I said, all right. I said, well, I would love to get off this field and give me some water, and I'm tired. But if I'm doing what I love, that means I got a block for it. He said, exactly. He said, you got to love it. I said, all right, I'm going to dig deep, MB. I said, but I've never forgotten. He always would say, do what you love and love what you do. So as we sit up here and we celebrate his life, we cannot forget that this is a person who was filled with inspiration. He was filled with purpose. He was filled with love. You've heard from all these gentlemen that he's touched their lives, and we've been connected to y'all's lives. He truly was somebody special. He was truly somebody who cared. He made me come out, just to let you know that right now. As an offensive lineman, I wasn't trying to do nothing. But between him and these jokers back here, he did not leave me alone. And I purposely think he didn't leave me alone because he wanted me to be included in everything. So, MB, I'm always remember, man, do what you love, but love what you do. Thank you.
How y'all doing? My name is Dante Jackson. I'm one of Marion's good friends in Dallas, Texas. And excuse me, I just kind of hard because I never thought I'd be going through this. But Marion became a brother to me in 2014. And from that point on, we was joined at the hip. And I remember Marion inviting me to his house. And I walk in, he got a Bible on the desk. And he's it's a picture I seen it here with him and his little brother on it. That's how I knew Thomas. And he always talked highly about his brothers, you know, his mom, his dad. And I remember Marion moving back home in Minnesota, to Minnesota a few years back. And he called me. He's like, man, I'm too grown to be here at mom and dad's house. Can I come stay? I said, if that's what you want to do, big bro, come on. I always called him big bro. And he would call me little brother in Christ or something like that. And he said, well, give me 3 weeks and I'll be back in Dallas. I said, okay. And he called me within an hour later. Can I come now? I said, yeah, Marion, come on. So he get to Dallas. I pick him up from the airport. You know, we was back at the house having fun. And I never forget, Marion was there for me in one of my hardest times. I almost lost my twin brother due to mental health issues. And when I got the call, and I just dropped everything and ran out the apartment, before I knew it, Marion was at the car before me. And, you know, we just had a real close relationship. And, you know, one of the funniest moments was I invite my girlfriend to the house, her and one of her friends, and Marion runs in the room. So we all having fun, watching TV and stuff, playing cards, and everybody leave. Marion come out the room. That's her friend? I said, why you go in the room? He said, okay, just put a date together. I said, okay, we're going to go on a date. So we invite the girls to Papado's, and we sitting at the bar. The girls walk in. Marion asked for a Shirley Temple. Everybody else a vodka and cranberry. Before I know it, he looked at his phone. He said, I got to step out and accept this call. I said, okay. Before I know it, I'm looking at my phone. It's him calling me. So I walk away from the girls. What's going on, Marion? Please come outside.
What?
So I go outside, he tell me, I don't know what to say. I said, just start a conversation. Everybody know Marion was a shy guy, man. And I'm going to end this and say I love him. Condolences to the family. Marion was a good friend to me. And I'm going to love him, you know, and I'm going to miss him. Thanks, y'all.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Nick Strews. I grew up with Marion at Wayzata. We all know how this is and what it is. Thank you for everybody coming out today. Obviously, the family. Blessings. Dear Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you for blessing all of us with Marion Barber III. In Jesus' name, amen.
To the family, I'm Tracy Bransford. I was not going to speak, but Karen said you should go on and speak. To the Haddons, to the Barbers, I've known Marion all his life. I remember when Karen was pregnant with him and my grandmother was still alive, and she said, "You're as big as a tick. You're about to drop this baby," you know. So it goes back to that. We talked a lot about Marion being a God-loving man, and that's what I want to speak on briefly. But I'm also going to talk about trust, because Karen and Marion, and my journey with Marion, was about trust. When he was a baby, and big Marion had to play for the Jets, right? Because we all know that. Where was he playing? In New York. And where was I? In New York, going to law school. So Mama Bear was like, "You're going to watch my baby? Okay, I guess so." So I'm either going out to Long Island or they're bringing him through NYU Law School, but it was pretty much come on out to Long Island so Marion can go on and play with the Jets. When Dom was born, little Marion was no longer just little Marion, so he had Dom to deal with. And Dom was looking just like that, just as cute, just laying to the side, just kicking it as just one of these pictures. But little Marion was like, okay, we got somebody else around. So every time I'd like, you know, they'd be eating whatever, and I'd a little pop. I was like, not little Marion popping Dom, what's up? Right? So he had his own like jealousy kind of thing happening, whatever. I was like, little Marion, you don't pop Dom, because one day he's gonna be big enough and he's gonna pop you back. So you just, you know. So fast forward, life happened, and whenever I would see Marion, it would just be, you know, family, affairs, what have you. But there was something special, and it was about God. And I was just like, I don't know why this, you know, child has such an in tune nature with God. My father almost passed years ago when my son was about 2 years old. And all I knew was that someone said, you know, little Marion was there with my dad. My dad, they called him father. He's now passed away. But he was at, I mean, he was literally about to be a major star. I think it was 2006/07. And I was like, he was what? You mean big Marion? They were like, no, little Marion was by your dad's bedside like for like 10 hours or what? I mean, I was like, when did he have time to come pray with dad? He did. My father lived many years beyond that, just passed 2 years ago. There's a theme of him loving God that I just wanted to share with you all. And as I got older, he told his mom and dad, again, trust. I want to talk to Tracy. I want her to represent me. So I know there was some other lawyer up here, but they trusted me with their son. And he asked her, can Tracy represent me? And so then it was just like, okay, I'll do this. And the life that he was leaving in the pro ball that we all talked about and going into his business, he was dead serious about the foundation. He would set up meetings. We would have meetings down. We would be at, I don't know where, having a business meeting with an agenda, going through, because he was making sure the foundation and the kids in Dallas or the kids here or who was coming up to the camp, he was always about the business of making sure whoever was in need was getting theirs to the fault of himself. And as a lawyer, you're like, okay, now, what you gonna give away? Or, I mean, you know, it's all good and we love it, but that was his nature and that was his natural spirit. And so I just leave that we now trust that God has got him. The last time I saw him was at your graduation, Thomas. And thank you for trusting me with your son, and God bless the family.
My condolences go out to the Barber family. My name is Skip Pete. I was a running back coach of the Dallas Cowboys when Marion played there. Very, very tough. When I heard the news, I mean, I couldn't believe it. And to this day, it still hurts. I mean, he's a very, very special man. I think everybody's talked about the different accolades and his work ethic and the things that he brought to the table and what he did to other people. I want to thank you two for bringing him into my life. Probably the most unselfish human being I've ever met. I first took the job in 2007. There's multiple backs in Dallas. Had the opportunity to meet with all of them. Kind of set the precedent of what our plans were for that season. Everyone had an idea what their role would be. He simply said one thing. He said, "Coach, whatever you want me to do." I said, "All right, that's good, because these other ones have been a little tough." But I go, "Don't worry about it. You'll get your opportunities. You'll get your touches." But to make a long story short, as it went on, and obviously he had a pretty good season, and that's the year he went to the Pro Bowl. But probably one of the first guys to ever go to the Pro Bowl as a backup running back. But the one thing that never left my mind about Marion was his tremendous work ethic, his love for his friends, his family, his brothers, but the way he went about it. I've had an opportunity to coach for a long time. Who knows how much longer? Several guys I coach are over there. Now, when I look at a portrait of what I want in a man, not only the football player, but a man, I want him to be physical, kind, hardworking, and just have the desire to be the best that they can be every single day. That's how he walked into the building. That was Marion. I didn't have to worry about him. He rubbed off on everybody else. He actually helps me set the mold for when I go out and I evaluate running backs, that's what I want. It's hard to find. You don't have that type of style and that type of demeanor that he possessed at that particular time in his life. That's the man I'm going to remember. That's the guy I'm going to remember. How he would come to my house, sit, play with my kids when they were a lot younger, like they were family. He was family to me. He's family. He's family. I don't want to be too long, but I want to thank you for giving me an opportunity to work with your son. Very special. Some of these guys probably get tired. Every time I show an example of how you should do something, whether it's running the ball, whether it's blocking, whether it's catching, whether it's just the way you approach every day, preparation for week in and week out game plans, that was Marion. You know, and I said, you know, if one guy can set an example for a position, it's him. I love him. I miss him. And I'm glad that you guys are all here, because I think he touched us in all a very, very special way. I always miss him. I love him. I love him. Love you.
All right. Well, we're not going to hold you too much longer, but just hang with me for this right here, okay? Because we're going to end this thing right. So I promised that this would be a time of remembrance and tribute and reflection, but also a celebration. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to have Sounds of Blackness come back up and sing one of their most popular songs, my favorite song, Marion's favorite song. And I think everybody named Marion in the Barber family's favorite song, Optimistic. And then I'm going to close us out with some brief words. I promise it won't be church, there won't be an offering, or it won't be a sermon. You're going to have this great song, and then I just want to send us out right with some brief words, and then we're going to go, all right? So let's bring back the Sounds of Blackness.
Never say die.
Never say die. Never say die.
The blackness. Blackness. Keep on. Never say die.
midst of sorrow. You can see up when looking down. A brighter day tomorrow will bring. Oh. You hear the voice of reason telling you this can never be done. No matter how hard reality seems, just hold on to your dreams, yeah.
Don't give up, don't give in. Although it seems you never win, you will always pass the test as long as you keep your head to the sky. You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. Be optimistic
when things around you crumble. No, you don't have to stumble and fall. Keep pushing on and don't you look back. No, I know the storms and strife cloud up your outlook
on life.
Just think ahead and you'll be inspired to reach higher and higher.
You will always do your best if you learn to never say never. You may be down, but you're not out. So don't give up and don't give in. Although it seems you never win, you will always pass the test as long as you keep your head to the sky. You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. You can win. Optimistic, you can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. Be optimistic, you can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. Be optimistic, you can win long as you keep your head to the sky. Be optimistic. You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky.
Amen. Thank you, Sounds of Blackness. Consider these words as we get ready to depart from this place from 1 John chapter 3. It says, see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God. And what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him. We shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. I want to share these words from this title, Getting Positive Yardage Out of Life. Getting positive yardage out of life. Because we live in a world that is not perfect, because we live in a world that is somewhat broken and upside down, because we live in a world where we have circumstances and experiences that we would even say were not fair, we have to learn at times in life how to take a deficit and turn it into a positive. Many of you are sitting here today and you find yourself where you are because you learned over time how to take a negative and turn it into positive. You learned how to take words that would have harmed you and limited you and kept you from being what you were created to be, but you turned it into a positive. You took the teasing and you turned it into a testimony. You took the abuse and it became your anointing. You took the harm and it became a road for your healing. You know how to turn a deficit into a positive. I watched some highlight reels from Marion Barber III a couple weeks ago just to remind me of his career. And there was this game against the New England Patriots where the Dallas Cowboys have the ball inside their own 5-yard line. And Romo hands it off to Marion. And it looks like it should be a safety for the New England Patriots. I mean, he's in the end zone and somehow he escapes the first tackler. That was just explained to us because I guess one man's not going to bring him down. So he escapes the first guy. And again, a second guy comes and it should be a safety for the Patriots. And he makes his way out to the right and he turns what should have been a deficit, what should have been negative yardage into positive yardage. This is really the story of his life. His ability to take what would have meant a burden and make it a blessing. He realized on some level who he was in God. So how do we do this? How do we find and make blessings in the midst of brokenness? How do we find something divine in the midst of deficits? Well, we can follow Marion on this. Marion was made in the image of God and he was loved by God. So 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 rings true for him, that God lavished his love on him, that God loved him real good. He was made in the image of God. He was loved by God. He was gifted by God. He was purposed by God. And we can lean into that same truth for us. Regardless of your background, regardless of your race, regardless of your slang, your ethnicity, what you've been through, the way that you can turn a deficit into positive yardage in your life is to know that you are loved, that you are worthy, that you are valuable. You are made in the image of God. The Imago Dei is on you. The creator of the universe has an imprint on your life. And so you can turn a deficit into a positive by knowing, just like Marion knew, that you're made in the image of God, that you're loved by God. But also, Marion was compassionate and generous. Later, it says here in 1 John chapter 3, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? So we find out from this text that ultimately the love of God in you is not based on church attendance. The love of God in you is not based on how many scriptures you memorize. The love of God in you is not based on if you've lived a perfect life or not. The love of God in you is not how many hymns you've memorized. The love of God in you is your ability in a tough, tough world to be compassionate and generous no matter what. To see people before yourself. To see the circumstances of other people before your own circumstances. Marion was made in the image of God. He was loved by God. So yes, he's Marion and Karen's child, but ultimately he is the child of God and he is in his ultimate everlasting home right now. The mansion that was prepared for him, he is living in it, is beyond any experience he could have on earth because he's loved by God, he's made in the image of God. But Marion was compassionate and generous. But Marion was also tough. Marion was tough on the field, and he was tough on himself. If you really knew Marion, you knew that the toughness that he brought to the football field, he was so tough on himself, to the point that he didn't want to burden people. He didn't even want to burden his own mom and dad. He didn't want to burden his brothers.
even though they were like, no, it's okay. You can share it all with us. You can put it all on us. But he that toughness that he brought to the field, he brought it off the field to the point that he didn't want to burden anybody. And he was tough in his own heart. But the Bible has a word for that. It says in verse 19, this is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in God's presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts. What this is saying is, if you're tough on yourself, if you don't see yourself as special as other people see you, if you don't always see the value in yourself that other people see in you, if for some reason you condemn your own self in your own heart, God's love is greater than your condemning of yourself. God's love is greater than any burdens you carry on the inside of you. Like, you can release your manhood, your womanhood, your single life, your marriage, your family, your career, your finances, your time, your priorities. You can release it to the love of God. You can allow God's love to be lavished on you, and you can allow God's love to be transferred into compassion and empathy and generosity and unity and reconciliation and forgiveness in this world. And if there was ever a time where this world could use more forgiveness, more love, more peace, more unity, more empathy, more compassion, that's right now. Can I get an amen on this football field? So since I'm on this football field, let me just roll myself to my conclusion. Coach Fleck, I want to end this message by saying we're all running backs. Yeah, I know. There was a lot of Cowboys up here from different positions, but in this moment, everybody's a running back. And this is what I've learned about successful running backs to be successful in life. A running back, in order to get positive yardage, in order to score, in order for a running back to get to their destination, two things have to be possible. One, they have to be handed the ball. The ball has to get to them. The running back doesn't start with the ball. So to be successful in life, something has to be handed to us. Now, I'm not talking about some pity or some charity. I'm saying maybe we need to recognize, as running backs in this game of life, that we've all been handed something. You've been handed the image of God. You've been handed talents and gifts. You've been handed time. You've been handed breath in your body. You've been handed gifts. You've been handed abilities. You've even been handed your past and even the brokenness of your journey so you could turn it around and you could run to something greater. So all of us are running backs on this field because we've all been handed something. And the question is what do you do with the ball in your hand? Even when people are trying to tackle you, when people are trying to injure you, when people are trying to take you out, when people are trying to convince you that you're less than who God has created you to be. I know we're not in church, we're on a football field. But what are you going to do when the ball is in your hand? Marion is no longer here. He's in glory now. But the ball's in your hand. The ball's in your hand now. What will you do? So that's why I learned one thing about running backs. You got to get the ball and decide what you're going to do with the ball in your hand. But here's the other thing I learned about successful running backs. Successful running backs know what to do with daylight. Because successful running backs feel like they only need just a little bit of room. If they can just, in football language, some people call it opening a hole. So you're opening a hole. Some people say it's daylight. It's almost like as soon as you get the ball, all the world is dark. But if you got the right offensive linemen in front of you that provide daylight for you, you can get to the end zone. You can score points. You can pick up a first down if you can just find daylight. I came here to tell you today that over 2,000 years ago, Jesus came to a dark world and he provided daylight so you could see your destiny, so you could see your future, so you could see your goals, so you could see your purpose. whether you believe in God or not, you've got to admit that something beyond your rationale, something beyond your philosophy, something beyond your ideology, something beyond Kierkegaard has helped you find daylight. Ah, there were people that were against you. There were people that thought you couldn't win. There were people that thought nobody from that neighborhood makes it. Oh, they weren't even looking at Marion Barber III. Coach just admitted it up here. Coach Mason said nobody was even recruiting him. But I believe that Marion Barber III thought, if I could just get daylight, if I could just get one school to look at me, if I could just get one running back coach at the Dallas Cowboys to think that I can make it, all I need is daylight. Daylight for your healing. Daylight for your strength. Daylight for your destiny. All I need is daylight. Some people need a hole this wide. Just give me this. Just give me some daylight. Okay, I'm really closing now, because you know how preachers are. We always say, this is my close, and then this is really it right here. Like, this is it. I was on the continent of Africa. I'm thinking about this because the sounds of blackness. They've taken me back to my roots. So I was on the continent of Africa. I was in Kenya, and I went on a safari. And I was excited to go on this safari, and I saw zebras and lions and elephants. But the safari guide was really excited about the impala. I thought the impala was a car. I didn't even know it's an animal in Africa. And so the safari guide told us that the impala, just on all fours, can jump 13 feet high in the air. And when the impala's running, it can not only jump 13 feet high, it can jump 30 feet out. It's its God-given ability. And I thought, wow, this thing just standing can jump 13 feet high. And if a lion comes at it, it can jump 30 feet out. Wow. So I came back to the United States, and I was at the San Francisco Zoo, and I saw some impalas there. But the impalas at the San Francisco Zoo, they were different. They were initially contained by a 3-foot wall, and they wouldn't jump over it. So I tried to talk to them. I said, look, I just saw y'all cousins in Africa. I don't know if y'all noticed, but y'all can jump 13 feet high and 30 feet out. You don't have to take these conditions. Impala lives matter. But they didn't listen to me. So I talked to this lady who worked at the zoo, and she said, oh, when the impalas are babies, we found out that they won't jump if they can't see where they're gonna land. So when they're babies, we build this 3-foot wall, and even though they have the ability, they can jump way over that wall, they won't, she said, because they won't jump if they can't see where they're gonna land. She said, I don't know if this makes sense to you, but they don't have faith. I said, oh, you shouldn't have told me that. I don't know what the future holds, Marion and Karen, Thomas and Dom, but I know you have the ability to jump. There's no 3-foot wall that will keep you from moving forward, that will keep you from healing, that will keep you from getting stronger, that will keep you from continuing the legacy of the Barber family. It's not over. There is a legacy still to build. There are more generations to come. There is more of those made in the image of God, gifted by God, loved by God. I don't know, sisters and brothers, what the future holds. I just say we jump anyway. I don't know where we're going to land. I wish that I was that kind of prophet, Coach Fleck, that I could tell you exactly how the season is going to go this year. But I just say jump anyway. Jump into the season anyway. I don't know what's going around the corner. I don't know what's on the horizon for any of you in here. But don't stop jumping. Don't let any 3-foot wall, don't let prejudice, don't let discrimination, don't let sexism, don't let racism, don't let murderous thoughts, don't let unforgiveness, don't let selfishness, let no 3-foot wall keep you from jumping. Even Van Halen said you might as well jump. Go ahead and jump. Somebody else in hip hop said, jump around, jump around, jump up and get down. Ah, stay on the good foot and jump. Make something of your life. Make something of your family. Make something of your marriage. Make something of your parenting. Make something of your finances. Make something of your gifts and abilities by staying tough on the field, and stay tough
and generous in life. That's all I got for y'all. That's it. That's all I got. God bless you. God keep you. God love you. And may you know that you are made in the image of God. We're going to close out. You're going to hear some music from Sounds of Blackness in the background as we close out. But let me close us with this prayer. Creator of the universe, we thank you for the gift of Marion Barber III. You have decided to bring that gift home, to bring it into eternity. No pain for Marion Barber III, no sorrow for Marion Barber III, no burden, no sickness, no hurt, no harm, no danger, at peace. So God, give us the ability to keep jumping over 3-foot walls, to keep looking for daylight, and to take this ball that you've given us called life and score. Let it be done in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Never say die.
Never say die. Never say die.
The blackness. Keep on.